alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Al-Madina was inhabited by the Ansar. Al-Madina has farms. Why? There's water, there's trees, there are palm trees. Unlike Mecca, Mecca doesn't have all that. Al-Madina does. When the Sahaba went to Al-Madina, the people in Mecca were business people. Why? There's no farms. So what do you do if there's no farms? You do business. رِحْلَةَ الشِّتَاءِ وَالصَّيْفِ. You go one journey in the summer, one journey in the winter. You do what you have to do to earn your what, to earn your money. In Medina, there was more, less of business people, more of farmers, landowners. They owned land, a lot of land. And that's wealth. This is different kind of wealth. طبعاً الأنصار رضي الله عنهم, when the Meccans came, the Sahaba from Mecca, المهاجرين, they came, the Ansar said, you know what, you don't have to do anything. You don't have to work. You don't have to do anything. Here you sit, you are our guests. Your land will give you a place to build your home from our land. We'll give you, your food is taken care of. Don't worry about your food. Don't worry about doing anything. Here it is for you. You live easily. You came with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You're on us. Done. Lakin the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not want that. That's nice. That's nice. Lakin that's not what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted. He wanted not. He did not want them to give them a fish. He wanted them to teach them how, or to enable them to fish. And that's why you all know what happened after the money came to him, and he took, gathered the Ansar and told the Ansar, look, I have lots of money. You want me to divide it between you and the Muhajirin equally, or would you, and you share with them and empower them and allow them to do business, meaning not just to eat, but enable them. So let me give them that money so I can enable them to actually earn a living on themselves. Let me empower them so they don't live as a burden on you, though you don't see it this way, but that should not be this way. Let me allow them to blossom and grow just like you ought to blossom and grow. Well, that's exactly what the Ansar radiallahu ta'ala anhum did. Oh, you know how Allah Ta'ala praised the Ansar, etc., etc., and all these things. Al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does not want from the dunya to be a veil of the akhirah. That's why Al-Quran puts the akhirah before the dunya. Because if you're not seeing the akhirah while you're in the dunya, you're seriously veiled. And this short-lived enjoyment will not last. And therefore Allah said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim here, وَابْتَغِ فِي مَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. Seek in that which Allah has given you at Dar al-Akhirah. Then do not forget your share in the dunya. There's a share for you in the dunya. Enjoy. Again, with what? With the vision of the Akhirah before. The home is not here. That's why Quran al-Kareem used the word ad-dar. That's not your dar. This is the dar of fana, a dar of perishing. Darul baqa is there. If you just invest everything you have in a fani, in something that will perish, everything that you do will also perish with it. Therefore, the soil will eat your clothing, and the soil will eat the food that you eat also, no matter how delicious and expensive it is. And the soil will eat your body as well. But the soil can never eat your refined soul. The soil can never eat your principled living. The soil can never eat your iman, or your ihsan, or your Islam, or your akhlaq. The soil cannot eat these things. Soil does not recycle fikr or ideas and knowledge. Soil recites bodies and materials. That's what will go through the soil. And many of us before that have also been recycled. Makes no difference. Names are not important. Titles are not important. Possessions are not important. It's all soil belonging at the end of the day. But what remains, that's why Allah Azza wa Jal, when He described His Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, says, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. That remains, Ya Rasulullah. And akhlaq, your khuluq remains, of who you are, of how you conduct yourself, of how you live your life, of the qualities the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told us, from sidq, truthfulness, to trustworthiness, to faithfulness, to simple as shukr, gratefulness. Gratefulness, very simple. Otherwise the human being becomes like the poet. One of the poets speaks about, he says, you know, basically, كَكَلْبِ صَيْبٍ, he says, the one that doesn't see that, he'll become like a hunting dog. يُمْسِكُ وَهُوَ طَاوٍ فَرِيسَتُهُ وَيُطْعِمَهَا سِوَاهُ. He catches his hunt, but even though the dog is hungry, he can't eat it. He has to give it to someone else. That's all he does. He just hunts and puts, hunts and puts, hunts and puts. He doesn't benefit and others don't benefit. Well, the point of life is that actually it's visioned. There's direction in this life. طيب. وَابْتَغِ فِي مَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. Allah says, which means do not forget your share in dunya. Do good in this dunya. Do good. Well, everything you do, you'll see it anyway. Do good with what you say, with what you intend, with what you do. Do good. Whatever Allah has given you, employ it in doing good. It doesn't mean you don't enjoy. It doesn't mean you don't acquire. But remember, you and what you acquire, as far as soil, are all acquisition of the soil eventually. So employ that which you acquire for a good thing. And amongst the most important things is the time that Allah has given you. Health, wealth, all that stuff. And then Al-Quran Al-Kareem says, وَأَحْسِن. أَحْسِن means do good. Do good here. What do you mean do good? كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. Just like Allah has done good to you, you ought to do good. Well, that is a bit difficult. And the reason for that is Allah does us good when we're worthy and when we're not worthy. We just mentioned that. And oftentimes we have our own standardization of who is worthy of receiving our good and who's not worthy. Al-Qur'an al-Kareem wants to change that in us. Why? Because Al-Qur'an al-Kareem wants us to be shakir. Yani muhsin. Muhsin means shakir lillah. Yani when you are وَأَحْسِن كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ, like do good just like Allah has done good to you. It means be grateful to others just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala treated you with His grace. Don't be ungrateful. Allah has done you good, you pass on that good to other people. And the reason for that is because sometimes when we withhold giving good, we only hurt ourselves. Shukr does not help Allah. Does Allah need our shukr? Yani when we say, how are you doing? Alhamdulillah, ashukrillah. Great, that's a good thing. Does Allah need us to say, thank you, Ya Allah? Look at Surah Luqman alayhi salam. And ishkur li wali, and then Allah says, وَمَنْ يَشْكُرْ فَإِنَّمَا يَشْكُرُ نَفْسِهِ. Whoever does shukr doesn't really do shukr to Allah. He does yashkuru li nafsih. He does shukr to himself. Allah does not need our shukr. But when you do actual shukr, and shukr here doesn't mean saying thank you. Shukr is three things: hand, heart, and tongue. Not just tongue say thank you, that's lip service. Like in this shukr, when you give shukr, Allah says, yashkuru li nafsih. When you do shukr, you actually help yourself. What do you mean you help yourself? You refine yourself. You perfect yourself. You elevate yourself. You illuminate yourself. Allah Ta'ala would like to see you kamil. More perfected. More reaching your maximum potential. When you are not thankful, you hurt only yourself. You don't hurt Allah. And when you're thankful, you don't help Allah. You only help refine yourself and elevate yourself. And Allah likes for the believer to be perfected. For Allah equipped the believer to be perfect. What's holding back is that will to be actually thankful. And therefore, وَإِن تَشْكُرُوا يَرْضَهُ لَكُمْ. Another ayah in the Quran, Allah says, which means, if you are thankful, Allah likes that for you. لَكُمْ. Not He likes that for Himself. No. If you are thankful, the meaning of the ayah, Allah likes that for you. He likes to see His slave perfect. Following the path of perfection. The path of the Anbiya. That's why the Prophet ﷺ called himself Shakur. Thankful. That's why the Al-Anbiya, Al-Saliheen, all this, they follow this path of Shukr. And Shukr and Shukr and Shukr. And that's why you see in another ayah, Iblis. He tells Allah Azza wa Jal, and the meaning of the ayah, he says, I will sit from on their right and on their left and from their back. And I will take over all their world. وَلَا تَجِدُ أَكْثَرَهُمْ شَاكِرِينَ. Then you will not find most of them shakirin. A sign of Iblis taking a hold of someone is you won't find him shakir. He didn't say you won't find him sabir. You won't find him mu'min. You won't find him this. No, don't worry. The highest level is shukr. That this person is conscientious of Allah Azza wa Jal and being grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a sign of that, obviously, as you know, is what? Is gratefulness with the hands, with the heart, and with the tongue all together. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to, you see in the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all these things. Yani when you see the hadith when the man comes to him and tells him, Ya Muhammad, give me. And he gives him, and he gives him, and he gives him, and he gives him. And until the man goes back to his tribe, and he tells them, you people should believe in this man, for he gives a giving of someone who doesn't fear poverty. Well, if you fear poverty, you fear creation. And you're supposed to be conscientious of the Creator. The creation can't hurt or help. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is an example of Tawheed. I'll give you the story also. Actually, it's a real story. Dr. Howard Kelly died in, I think, 42 or 45. I'm not sure anymore. Anyway, he's one of the so-called Big Four who established Johns Hopkins University in Maryland. Right, Big Four physicians, they call them the Big Four. He's among the Big Four. This man has a story, they say, devout Christian. He started his life selling door to door. Sells door to door. Eventually, he became a gynecologist, one of the most famous ones. He established, actually, the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology in Johns Hopkins University. Oncologic gynecology as well, cancer sort of gynecology and more. Anyway, very known. He says, or the story goes, it's known, and they speak about it. He goes, he used to knock doors to sell. Door-to-door sales, those of you who know door-to-door sales in the old days were tough sales. It's one thing now you have all this internet and all these e-marketing and all that, that's different. Door-to-door was like in the old days when they fought face-to-face with a sword. You require bravery. It's a different breed of people. Not sitting behind the buttons and pushing buttons right and left. No, that's anybody can do that. But door-to-door was tough. You have to convince the person in front of you and all these things, present all this, has to be ready for any answer, all that stuff. He says he used to go door to door and sell, makes little money. Until he obviously has lots of frustrations when you knock the door of the doors of the creation. Be ready for frustrations, my friend. All the time. When you knock the door of the creation, be ready for frustration. Normal. الإنسان خلق الإنسان ضعيفا، الإنسان ضعيف وعجول، hasty وجهول، ignorant and arrogant. You know, I mean all of us. Be ready for these kinds of things. Anyway, so frustrations mounted with him. He is trying to sell, to earn a living door to door as a young kid, or as a kid going through school, afwan, going through college. He says, I gave up until I was so hungry, I didn't want to spend the money I earned. So the next door, he said, I decided to ask for a meal or something to eat, not just, or a cup or a glass of water then maybe, he says. A glass of water. Can you give me a glass of water? And when you're hungry, even water helps. Sayyidina Abu Dharr, radiallahu anhu, hadith sahih. He says, I lived on Zamzam for many months. Bismillah. That's water diet. That's what he did. He says he gained weight. Sayyidina Abu Dharr gained, he is Zamzam. So, he says, I lived on Zamzam many months, I gained weight. Anyway. He says he wanted to ask now, because when you send, don't ask them to give you anything. You're trying to get them something and get out. He said he knocked the next door and a young woman opened for him. And without him asking, she saw how frail he was. She went and brought him a big glass of milk. Well, milk has all these things. She gave it to him. He told her, ma'am, can I pay you? Listen, old days, people don't have money, you know, even a glass of milk. And she told him, mother taught us not to accept a pay for kindness. Accept pay for kindness? Who says, when the Prophet ﷺ accepted pay for kindness? اذهبوا فأنتم الطلقاء. Go, you're free, you're pardoned. Give him, give him. She tells him, he says, then I'll remember this. I will always be thankful. Shukr, we're talking shukr. This young man grew up, became one of the top physicians in the nation eventually. Founded, like I said, Johns Hopkins University. And while he was working, and again, this is a true story, he found this woman from Pennsylvania in his department suffering from some kind of oncologic, some kind of cancer that's related to gynecology, to women. He helped fight the whole thing with her. He said he immediately recognized the woman when he went and saw her. At once he recognized that woman. Though it's been now a couple of decades, he recognized who she was. He recognized where she's from. And he was the one in charge of trying to provide her the best service possible until both they've, with the will of Allah, they've overcome the cancer that she had. But before that, he asked the accounting division to send him the bill. And you probably can imagine, even back then, how big that bill is. But he put a note on the bill before they sent it to the woman. This bill was paid in full by a cup of milk. Well, the Quran says, وَمَنْ يَشْكُرْ فَإِنَّمَا يَشْكُرُ لِنَفْسِهِ. Whoever does, remembers these things, you know, these are the values the Quran came. It's not about how, you know, your salah and your siyam, that's between you and Allah Azza wa Jal. That's important and that's fard if it's a fard salah. Like, and these are the things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam embodied from the salah, and embodied from the siyam, and embodied from the zakah. And these are the things that he passed on to the ummah of him, of his sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's why the Quran Kareem says here, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَابْتَغِي فِي مَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ. Seek in that which Allah has given you the hereafter. That's the dar, that's the home. If you're looking for a home elsewhere, you've got the wrong address, my friend. وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. Living the dunya, enjoy it, do what you can, do good, and move as clean as you came. It's going to be difficult. Dunya tarnishes. Few people were able to escape the tarnishing of the dunya, exiting it as clean and pure as they came in. Few. But the point is to try as much as we can, to leave it as good and clean and innocent as we came in. Allah says, وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. Do good just like Allah has done you good. Be thankful to Allah Azza wa Jal, just like Allah has done you good. Don't ever forget that. Don't ever be veiled by the gift from seeing the giver. Then you are blind. And you should not live this dunya or this life blind. Dunya is much bigger than that if you live it with a heart, because you started with the akhirah. Dunya is just a byproduct that's on the side. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا كما أمر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إرغاما لمن جحد به وكفر. أشهد أن سيدنا محمدا صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم الشفيع المشفع في المحشر. صل اللهم عليه وعلى آله للفقه والنظر والعلم والأثر، وعلى من بآثاره مقتفى واهتدى واعتبر. عباد الله، اتقوا الله العظيم حق تقواه، راقبوه مراقبة من يعلم ويعتقد بأنه يراه. تزودوا من دنياكم لآخرتكم عملا يحبه ويرضى. اعلموا أنه لا يضر وينفع، ويعطي ويمنع، ويصل ويقطع، ويخفض ويرفع إلا الله. واعلموا أن الله تعالى أمركم بأمر بدأ فيه بنفسه وثنى بملائكة قدسه، قال تعالى: ولم يزل قائلا عليما إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم. بارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما باركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، أعلي مولانا كلمة الحق والدين. اللهم من أراد بالإسلام والمسلمين خيرا فوفقه إليه، من أراد بهم غير ذلك فاهده يا ربنا سواء السبيل. آتي أنفسنا تقواها، زكها أنت خير من زكاها، أنت وليها ومولاها. اشف اللهم مرضانا، عاف مبتلانا، فك أسرانا، ارحم موتانا. يا الله، everyone who came to this blessed house of yours, in this blessed day of yours, in this blessed hour of yours, يا الله forgive all our sins and the sins of everybody يا رب العالمين. يا الله there are people who have needs, يا الله people who have illnesses, يا الله people who have difficulties. يا رب العالمين with your generosity and karam, يا الله turn all disease into ease يا الله, and grant people healing يا رب العالمين. Those who have difficulties make it easy for them يا الله. Those who have ill or sicknesses يا رب العالمين grant them healing from you. لا شفاء إلا شفاؤك يا رب العالمين. يا الله اجعلنا لك، يا الله make us among the ذاكرين to you, of you and the شاكرين to you يا رب العالمين. And يا الله gather us with the شاكرين and with the ذاكرين. يا الله do not make us among the غافلين يا الله. يا الله forgive our parents and our grandparents and our great grandparents يا الله. Give them جنة الفردوس يا رب العالمين. Parole them in with your rahmah into the highest level of Jannah يا الله. In the company of the أولياء and the صديقين and the شهداء and the أنبياء and the صالحين يا الله. And يا الله assemble us with them after a life filled with إيمان and إحسان and إسلام and good deeds يا رب العالمين. يا الله keep إيمان in our homes and in our hearts and in our children يا رب العالمين. يا الله grant us the opportunity to live with إيمان and to die on إيمان after a life filled with good يا رب العالمين that's pleasing you يا الله and pleasing to your رسول يا رب العالمين. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك يا ربنا سميع قريب مجيب للدعوات. وآخر دعوانا يعني الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله. الحمد لله، الحمد لله نحمده ونشكره، نستعين به جل وعلا، نستهديه ونستغفره، نعوذ به جل وعلا من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له إن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده صدق وعده ونصر عبده وأعز جنده وهزم الأحزاب وحده لا شيء قبله ولا شيء بعده وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا وعظيمنا وحبيبنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وعبد الله ربه حتى أتاه اليقين صل اللهم وسلم وبارك وجدد وضاعف وعظم ومجد على هذا النبي الأمين وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وارض اللهم عن أزواجه وذرياته وأصحابه وأحبابه والتابعين وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. أما بعد، عباد الله، أنصحكم ونفسي الآثمة بتقوى الله، أحثكم وإياها على طاعته، أحذركم وإياها وبال مخالفته جل وعلا ومعصيته، وأستفتح بالذي هو خير. يقول مولانا عز وجل في المحكم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، وابتغ فيما آتاك الله الدار الآخرة ولا تنس نصيبك من الدنيا وأحسن كما أحسن الله إليك. Part of the ayahs in Surah Al-Qasas. طبعا الآيات we're talking about قارون his people, etc. What happened with قارون. لكن as you all know, the rule in علوم القرآن أن العبرة بعموم السبب أو بعموم اللفظ لا بخصوص السبب. That the lesson learned is based on the generality of the verse, not the specific reason for revelation. Otherwise, the Quran becomes a book of history rather than a living book. So therefore, the lesson learned always is from the general wording of the verse rather than the specific reason on whom it was revealed or why. طبعا here القرآن الكريم starts in a direction maybe different than our direction where Allah says وَابْتَغِ فِيمَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ. Seek in that which Allah has given you the next ad-dar. Dar means home, the home in the hereafter, not this home. Usually you say I start with the dunya and then I go to the akhirah, but Al-Quran flips the scale around. He starts with the akhirah then comes to speak about the dunya. وَابْتَغِ فِيمَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ. Then Allah says وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ من الدنيا, and do not forget your share in the dunya. The order seems to be maybe for some of us out of order. Dunya then akhira. لا, القرآن الكريم is saying akhira then dunya. If the akhira is not before the dunya, there is no dunya nor there is akhira. In that sense, maybe يعني at least a point. Seek in that which Allah has given you الدار الآخرة ولا تنس نصيبك من الدنيا. Do not seek your share in the dunya. But notice it did not say your home in the dunya. It says دار only for the آخرة. As if dunya is not really home. There is no دار in the dunya. Your دار or your home is the آخرة. So don't delude yourself by building a home where there isn't a home anyway. And then the ayah continues on its third segment by saying, وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. Do good just like Allah has done good unto you. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. Allah does not like those who cause corruption and evil and fasad on earth. And this equation, maybe if we start with just the beginning of the surah, of the ayah, yani where Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling us the meaning of seek in that which Allah has given you the home in the hereafter, and do not forget your share in the dunya. Maybe this equation that Al-Quran is putting is trying to make a balance for us of between two things. Number one, the ni'mah of the dunya and the ni'am of the akhirah, or the ni'am in the dunya, yani the grace, the bounties, the endowments of Allah in the dunya, and the endowments that Allah has given us in the akhirah. Maybe on an our level, the sweetness of the ni'mas of Allah in the dunya versus the sweetness of the ni'mas of Allah in the akhirah. Both of them have the sweetness, ladha. Ladha, yani enjoyment, the enjoying of this. And that's why Al-Quran Kareem calls the dunya mata'. And mata' means, we translate maybe as enjoyment, but mata' lexically or linguistically speaking, it means the food the caravan or one who travels on camels used to take with them to sustain them on the trip. That's what mata' is. Well, Quran al-Kareem is saying that the whole dunya is mata'. It's just sustaining, sustenance on the trip. Now, if you think this sustenance is a trip, you're totally mistaken, and sadly mistaken. طيب, Al-Quran al-Kareem then wants to show us a difference or an equation between the enjoyment of things Allah gave us in the dunya and the enjoyment of things Allah gave us in the akhirah by simply saying, seek in that which Allah has given you the home in the hereafter. This is where you're homing. Well, you came from there, you're going there. Don't forget your share in the dunya. طيب. What are these enjoyments? The enjoyments of the dunya are there. For example, Al-Quran Kareem speaks about the enjoyment of wealth, the enjoyment of food even. Well, these things, you enjoy them so long you have them. But you don't always have them. When you're enjoying food, you're having a delicious meal, you'll enjoy that food so long they are on that bite is on your tongue. The taste buds are still tasting the bite. Once you swallow that, enjoyment is gone. You need another one now to taste it again. And it goes, then you need another one to taste it again. So therefore, the ladha or the enjoyment of this is really short-lived. And it lives, the sweetness or enjoyment of what you have in the dunya, it lives as long as it stays or you stay. For example, same example would be, let's say, having wealth, yani money, let's say. So that enjoyment will be there so long money is in your pocket. So long it's just like the bite is on your tongue. So long the money is there, you're still feeling, tasting the sweetness. Once the money goes, there's no more sweetness. Maybe the money doesn't go, you go. Money stays, you go. There's also no sweetness. Sihha, al-afiyah, health, all these things, you all know. You have them, you don't have them. Allah Ta'ala give us all. Al-Quran Kareem is trying maybe to show us a balance between the enjoyments we have in the dunya and the enjoyments we have in the akhirah. And saying in a way that I started with the akhirah because the enjoyments there are home and they're lasting. The enjoyments of the dunya, no matter how much they are, they're not going to last. They last so long you still have the bite on your tongue. But neither the bite will stay on your tongue, nor will you stay if it stays. Both of you are going. Clothing, you have them. Once you are done with them, enjoyment is gone. الإسلام أو القرآن الشريف بتقول us here, look at the enjoyment in the لذة of الآخرة, for example, being in the آخرة, the home in the آخرة, the life, الحيوان, القرآن الكريم calls الآخرة, the real life, the everlasting life. It's not this the restricted life, the life that's filled with disappointments and things and challenges. No, that life is a life of love. That life is a life that's unrestricted when it comes to the compassion, the mercy, the love Allah Azza wa Jalla gives you. Look at that life and try to enjoy that life. As if he's trying to say that the enjoyments of the dunya are maddiyat mostly. And the enjoyments of the maddiyat means materialistic. And the enjoyments of the akhirah are ruhaniyat. They're spiritual. And the materialistic with matter, once matter is done, matter is gone. But then the ruh or the soul will always be there. And that requires, in order for us to taste a materialistic enjoyment, it's easy. Because we rely on the body immediately. In order for us to taste or experience spiritual enjoyment, it requires a bit of an elevation, a bit of illumination, a bit of يعني رقي or سمو, one that goes a little bit higher and higher in their own selves, yani the perfection of the human being, that the human being is made from soil and soul, that the human being does not rest at the soul and at the soil and what the soil gives, but actually aspires to be a human being with the soul, not just the soil. The soil is just a vehicle while you're living, the soul is the one that stays. And therefore, experiencing the dunya with only the soil is actual spiritual blindness, as the Quran al-Kareem puts it directly. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Man kana fi hadhi a'ma, fahuwa fil akhirati a'ma wa adallu sabila. Whoever is blind in this dunya, why is he blind? Well, he never saw with his soul. He was always living with his soil. Soil needs, soil things, soil, all right, after the end, live however you want to live, the soil will remain with the soil, and the soil will part. Experiencing then that life with the soul, that's what the whole messages of Iman came, from Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, to Nuh, to Ibrahim alayhi salam, to Musa, to Isa, and to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is trying to tell that human being, you have reached your maximum potential. Don't just restrict your growth at the maximum potential of the soil. Reach. The sky ought to never be the limit. Your mind is without Iman. Some people then say, yani, what is this? Yani, this whole message of Iman from Musa or Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam said, yani, if you have to be a mu'min, you should not be enjoying the dunya. Oh, should be faqir, always poor, all these things. No. That's not what we're saying. Ad-dunya has rules if you want to get it. Allah placed those rules. Irrespective of your faith, irrespective of your character, irrespective whether you're good or evil as a doer. Yani, if you have a farm and you're a farmer, there are rules Allah Ta'ala put. If you apply these things, you're going to have fruits coming. Irrespective whether what your name is, or what your faith is, or what your color is, or what your language is, or whether you're a good a person or a person who doesn't do good. You follow the rules, you're going to get the results. That's how it is. Allah Azza wa Jal is not like us. What does that mean? Well, when we disagree with each other, sometimes, some people, Allah Ta'ala say, all of you are good people, alhamdulillah. That can some. When they disagree with each other, they fight them with food and water. Some people, they fight them, if they can, with breath. You can't even take air. If I can take away air from you, I will. La, Allah Azza wa Jal is not like that. Allah Azza wa Jal provides food and drinks for those who disbelieve in Him every single day. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Kullan numid. Allah says, we shall supply all. Ha'ula'i wa ha'ula'i. Those who believe and those who don't. Min ata'i rabbik. From the giving of your Lord. Wa ma kana ata'u rabbika mahzura. For the giving of your Lord is not restricted. You restrict when you fear. You restrict when you don't have. You restrict when you have short-sightedness, when you don't know. You restrict when you are incapable and not and powerless. You don't restrict when you are the Almighty. You don't restrict when everything is under your control. You do it according to your wisdom. And that's where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, when he was coming out of Egypt with his people from Bani Israel, coming out of Egypt, he tells them, Inna al-arda lillah. The people, this land, you see, Pharaoh is ruling, and you Israelites, the Israelis at that time, they believed in Musa. He's telling them that you see that now Pharaoh is killing you, he's slaughtering your women and children, and he's dishonoring you and enslaving and all this. And you believe, and he doesn't believe, he thinks he's God, wal-ayyadu billah. And while you are the believers, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was telling them, which Allah ta'ala said, Al-ard, O people, al-ard for Allah. He yurithuha, he gives it to whomever he wants from his slaves. But wal-aqiba lil-muttaqeen. But the end are for those who are conscientious of him. Don't be fooled by the short time span that Pharaoh is ruling. Don't let that shake your faith. This is a short-lived enjoyment of the dunya that he has. What is more, that Allah gives you short-lived enjoyment or you actually have an everlasting one? Who is the one who is deprived? Truly, al-mahroom. The one whom Allah Ta'ala took this from him, or the one whom Allah Ta'ala took other things from him. There's a thing that, or a story, yani, so take it or leave it, there is no sanad for it. Lakin, yani, qissa, or some. They say, one of the scholars passed by a man who was deaf, he was blind and had all his four limbs amputated. Not deaf, blind. And he said he passed by him and the man was raising his hand and making dua. Alhamdulillah alladhi faddalana ala kathirin min khalqih. Alhamdulillah that Allah favored me and granted me more favors and more things that He has given lots of His creation. I feel favored. And the man stopped. He says, Abdullah, or slave of Allah, you don't have anything. What do you mean? He said, isn't it enough that Allah gave me lisanan dhakira, a tongue that mentioned Him, wa qalban hadira, and a heart that's present with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Maybe the balance then there, Al-Quran Kareem is trying to make here, don't be always judgmental over what enjoyment it is. Tab'an, there's no problem. Al-Quran Kareem says, man arada al-ajila, عَجَّلْنَا لَهُ فِيهَا. If you want to seek the dunya, here, take it. It's all in front of you. Apply the rules like the farmer. Put the seeds, plow the soil, you're going to get the fruits, no problem. Apply yourself, seek it, you're going to get it. That's one thing for the dunya. But don't feel that having this dunya gives you a security of actual, whether it's happiness in this dunya or in the akhirah. And that's why today we've applied the rules of the dunya, of acquisition in the dunya. And we have more of this dunya. A lot more than our ancestors ever had. That just our, just last generation, forget like 1,000 years ago. Well, you look at some of the, that's why some of the tabi'een were so upset, and some of the sahaba, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's quarters or living where he used to live were demolished. They were demolished to expand the prophetic masjid at that time, early in the Sahaba time. And some of them, some of the Sahaba said, we wish that they have left them so the Ummah sees how its Prophet used to live. Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. No, the dunya is in front of you. Allah gave you. You apply the rules in the dunya, you'll get what's in the dunya. Don't worry about that. It's just that applying yourself, arming yourself with what the know-how, and seek it. If you want to get it, it's there in front of you. Like in the Quran Kareem is saying, وَابْتَغِي فِي مَا آتَاكَ اللَّهِ. The problem with this, the problem with the issue of seeing only the dunya, not putting the akhirah first, like Al-Quran says, وَابْتَغِي فِي مَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّرَ الْآخِرَةِ. Seek in that which Allah has given you the hereafter. And then do not forget your share in the dunya. You see how the tartib or the sequence, the order in the Quran, if it's the other way around, the dunya will overtake you and you will not be able to see the akhirah. Not only that, you would think you have the dunya because of you, your skills and wit. Your know-how is what gave you this versus those who don't have. Then you don't realize it's the one who gave you that you ought to appreciate and see. And that's why Allah says, وَابْتَغِي فِي مَا آتَاكَ اللَّهِ. That in which Allah has given you. You didn't really get it out of your own. Sure, you have to actually follow the cause and effect. But the giving is His, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The cause and effect is a cause and effect. Otherwise, people withhold. Those who don't see the akhirah, they will have two things they will withhold. And what will they do also? They think they've got it. Like Pharaoh, like Qarun said, قَالَ إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. When the people ask Qarun, how come you have all this? He says, it's knowledge I have. It's wit I have. عِلْم عِنْدِي. عِلْم, I know. Not you. You don't know this. I know how to do it. You don't know how to do it. Versus, notice what the Prophet ﷺ did when the Sahaba migrated to Al-Madinah. You all know this. Al-Madinah طبعا المنورة يعني بنور رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.